If I can sum up the published and verbal opinions of my great father-in-law, Zatzal, Rav Moshe Feinstein, he held halacha lamase. A neighbor of mine, who was a Chabadnik, needed a lung transplant. Actually, at a time when they couldn't do lung transplants, so you had to do a heart-lung transplant, because they knew how to connect the heart. They didn't know how to cut the lungs and reconnect them. She had a heart-lung transplant in Pittsburgh. After consulting with the Lubavitcher Rebbe Zatzal, who sent her to Rav Moshe, and Rav Moshe approved the heart-lung transplant there, declaring the donor dead. Rabbi Feinstein wouldn't allow that kind of rationalization, that the donor could be killed in order to save the life of a Jewish patient. The opinion of Rabbi Feinstein is recorded in the Igros Moshe. There was a tshuva, a responsa, that he wrote to me. It didn't concern organ donation. It concerned when can you stop the ventilator once a patient was declared brainstem dead. And there was no issue of organ donation there. The issue was simply, can you remove the ventilator? And Rabbi said, of course. Once you can show that he's not breathing independently, then you remove the ventilator. Here we didn't have another motivation, namely to save another human life, just to bury this one. Strangely enough, one of the opponents to brainstem death determination had the lack of integrity to make a statement in print that Rabbi Feinstein's son, my brother-in-law, David Feinstein, had said that his father never approved of brainstem death. That went around the Jewish world. And what was missing was a little integrity of someone calling Reb David to ask, is it so? No one did. As at least the person did not, and kept on lecturing and publishing in print. Finally, I called my brother. I said, what's going on here? He said, you know, how many times we discussed this with our father, there's no issue. He's printed. And he wrote a letter to the opposition, which was delivered by hand. Didn't change. The following lecture at a conference, the same repetition of a canard of this lie, until Rebbe wrote a second letter, and where he stated, my father said, a person is dead if his brain doesn't allow him to breathe autonomically, even if the heart is beating. I put underlined there. That quieted down the rumor, but never received an apology or retraction from those people who spread the rumor. And there's where halacha is debased by lack of integrity. Behind all halachic decision is the absolute integrity of the decisor. Once that integrity is questioned, then the halacha is denigrated in the process. The key final test in the Harvard Criteria Protocol, or as I prefer, the President's Commission Brainstem Protocol, since I was active in testifying for that commission. The key is apnea. once you check the function of all the cranial nerves, there's no pupillary response, there's no oculomotor response when you put in ice water in the ear, there's no gag reflex, everything has been checked. The person is not declared dead. Until then, you check whether he can breathe in any way, a little bit, sometimes on his own. That's known as the apnea test. That's performed by stopping the ventilator without hurting the patient. Now that is done by saturating the patient with 100% oxygen for 20 minutes and then turning off the ventilator, the pump, while leaving the cannula, leaving the little pipe, still leaking oxygen into the body. You could do it to a healthy patient. Pearl divers learned that technique. They don't use scuba outfits. They just, on land, before they go under, they breathe pure oxygen, then they can stay under for 10, 12 minutes. This is what's done. If during that period of time, the carbon dioxide rises to what's known as 60 millimeter mercury, which is the amount that stimulates the brain to begin breathing. If the patient does not, then the patient is dead. So that there is not a doubt of whether, well, maybe there's enough blood to let the patient breathe. Well, that's the final test. If he should fail any of the other tests, meaning he should win any of the other tests, and any of the other cranial nerve tests, that's really what they are, show that there's still activity, then they don't even do the apnea test. Apnea test is only after everything has failed and he's shochev kemes, as Rashi says. Then, instead of using a feather, we use an apnea test. Now, the modern ventilators have what's known as a SIGH meter, S-I-G-H, so that they measure any time the patient takes an independent breath. Really, by the time you do a brainstem death determination, the staff knows pretty well that the patient's not breathing because the SIGH meter does not indicate any attempt to breathe independently or autonomically. So that the apnea test is a kind of a final test. That test really has been done already by looking at the meter.
Okay.
This question you ask, which is really the old question, how do you differentiate a brain-dead patient from a comatose patient? When the issue was presented to my great father-in-law, Moshe Feinstein Zatzal, at that time, nobody had a clear definition. The Harvard criteria were published. The doctors were not convinced they could differentiate between a brain-dead and a comatose patient. And that's what took Rabbi Feinstein 2 years before he ruled on this. During this period of time, I took him to see at Downstate Medical College, Kings County, what a brainstem patient looks like. And I remember what seemed to impress him most as definitive, the fact that, of course, the patient with shochev kemes wouldn't respond to any kind of stimuli, the eye, pupillary response, etc. But the fact that he had no gag response, that they could put a tongue depressor down his throat and the patient lie there. And this somehow is something a person can experience, knowing I couldn't do that. I couldn't, you have to gag. That somehow convinced them more than all the other tests. The patient must be dead. No one would allow it to happen and not respond if he were still alive. But Rabbi Feinstein became very sophisticated in this matter. We had down from Albert Einstein College of Medicine, we had down heads of department, surgeons, kidney transplant people who came to the house, and one of them slept over. I mentioned his name, I don't know if he wants his name on there. Actually, they spoke long into the night, and Rabbi Feinstein invited him to sleep over so they can continue in the morning. And then it took 2 years before Rabbi Feinstein now had it clear in his mind, a comatose patient is alive, a PVS patient is alive, a Lou Gehrig patient is alive even though he can't move. I brainstem, dead patient is dead. The first opposition came about when the statement was made, Rabbi Feinstein never wrote such a tshuva, that it was printed by me in the Igros Moshe. I responded to that, whoever asked the question, by sending him the handwritten tshuva, as Rabbi Feinstein wrote all his tshuvas on this lined paper. So you have his handwriting. No one else could do so. And then the second issue came about when someone with in an unconscionable way declared that Rabbi Feinstein's son had denied that his father ever had approved a brainstem death. So Rav David Feinstein Shlita wrote a letter which was delivered by hand to the one who had started that rumor without much success, because the rumor was repeated. And finally, Rav David wrote a second letter in which there he said, I heard from my father that the person whose brainstem death is dead, even though the heart is beating there. That seemed to quiet down the opposition finally. And here, possibly, it's just, this is the picture of the lamb that was born after the sheep was decapitated. Rabbi Feinstein received a request for clarification whether organ donation is a mitzvah from Rabbi Weiss Zatzal when he was Rav in Manchester. Rabbi Weiss then became the head of the Beis Din Tzedek in Yerushalayim. And Rabbi Weiss received an answer. So happens that I was at that time invited to Manchester to give a graduation address. I delivered it by hand. And Rabbi Feinstein wrote, and it's found in Igros Moshe, the second chelek of Yoredeya, the very last response from there is written to Rabbi Weiss, in which he says organ donation being, not discussing brain death, but organ donation per se, is a great mitzvah and should be done. To which Rabbi Weiss wrote a response, which I delivered by hand back to Rabbi Feinstein, saying, but you realize that families suffer great anguish over the thought of a loved one being mutilated. And the halacha is a broad principle, an umbrella principle. Halacha does not require you to suffer anguish in performing a mitzvah. This is Rabbi Weiss's response. Therefore, you say it's a mitzvah to give an organ, to allow organ donation, but the family will suffer anguish. Money you're supposed to spend to do a mitzvah, but not anguish. Only two mitzvahs require you to suffer. That's circumcision, milah, and Yom Kippur. To which Rabbi Feinstein answered, also published in that response, indeed, you're correct that the halacha does not require you to suffer anguish to perform a mitzvah. But don't you realize that the mitzvah is not to feel any anguish when you're saving a human life? That's the main mitzvah, he said. The mitzvah says, don't you be anguished. You're saving a human life. Nothing could give you greater joy than that.